The drought in Oregon actually started a few years ago, and if we go back to 2013, we had a winter with very low snowpack. And snowpack's important because it provides a lot of our surface water supply and our soil moisture in our drier summer months. As we moved into 2014, we had a really hot summer, and that doesn't help conditions either when you're already stressed for water. As we moved into the winter of 2014, we saw a similar situation to 2013 in that we weren't building snowpack, but it wasn't because of a lack of precipitation, it was our really warm winter. So storms would move in, they'd fall as rain, and they just weren't staying up in the mountains. This year really demonstrated the importance of water conservation and restoration projects around the state, and communities have been undertaking them for a number of years, not just because of drought, but they really paid dividends this year.
Even though we had less snow during the 2014-2015 season that we did in 13-14, we were able to open for 38 days versus not opening at all that previous year. We got creative with how we used the snow that we got. Just because we got less snow was no reason for us to give up trying, so we moved it out to the hill from areas we could find it and ended up with 38 days of operation as a result. Some of the things that we're going to be doing for the future, knowing that this won't likely be the last low snow year that we'll encounter. In fact, history shows that there are drought periods here, and you know this organization has done well to adapt in ways over the years. But we'll add things to that, such as putting ramps at the deck, actually wooden ramps and decks at the lifts that will allow us to open the lifts with less snow. In the West, we tend to build lifts very high off the ground because we're used to getting 300, 400 inches of snow. Where I come from on the East Coast, we're used to opening on a foot of snow, and therefore, building these ramps is something that would be kind of new to this organization, at least. Much like other ski areas across the nation, we're looking at doing some summer operations up here. I should say more summer operations. We're currently doing weddings and events at the lodge during the summer. We have a lot of races that are based out of here that we help support, and maybe some concert series. But we have a proposal in with the Forest Service right now to provide summer recreation. That would be zip lines, rock climbing wall, bungee trampoline, disc golf, things of that nature. And the win there is, you know, in these hot summer days, it's going to be over 100 degrees in the valley today. It's 74 degrees up here right now and nice breeze. It's a beautiful place to be during those hot days. So that'll help us to be not so dependent upon snowfall and, kind of diversify the business so that we can spread out, the use of the asset and to make money in other seasons.
Restoration is, I think, a really important part of long-term drought management, and I think will play an increasing role in mitigating the effects of drought. Essentially, restoration is about restoring the health and the resiliency of the river's ecosystem function. How well can a river withstand going without the usual flows that it's used to experiencing and experiencing higher than normal temperatures?
We're in Curry County on the southwest Oregon coast, about 40 miles north of California. So it's an area that's very warm in the summertime, very wet and rainy in the wintertime, and we have very warm stream temperatures. Recreationally, salmon provide a big boost to our economy. We have a lot of fishermen, a lot of guides here, and salmon are a big part of the economy on the south coast. So our ideas here are to restore riparian areas so that we can create optimal habitat and optimal water conditions for spawning salmon. If the water does get heated, it gets warm and fish have to spend more time in cold water refugiate, less time feeding, and they grow slower and are less healthy. And what we saw initially is that there was a huge spike in temperature, especially during the middle of the day on the lower part of this creek. And our goal was to remove that spike. And so we came in and did this riparian restoration, and we looked, we started looking the very next year. There wasn't much change for about 3 or 4 years. By 2000, the 5 years after the project was initiated, we had dropped the temperature 6 to 7 degrees between the upper and the lower part. By 2004, we had matched the temperatures almost perfectly. We began this project in 2003. We came in here and this was just a grassy pasture. We constructed the new channel and then planted trees, and this is what it looks like now in 2015. So this project was designed to augment flow in Gallagher Creek, and we succeeded in doing that. We know we succeeded because water table monitors showed us that we increased the water level, but we also know that from Gallagher Creek, where we've augmented the flows in Gallagher Creek. We probably added 3 to 4 weeks additional flow onto Gallagher Creek as a result of this project.
You know, the forecasts without action are pretty grim. I think where we would all expect water quality to deteriorate if the status quo were to prevail. I think if restoration efforts continue to accelerate, which they are, there's a growing conservation community, there's a growing level of coordination between conservation partners in the Rogue. Planning is approaching a level of detail that it never has before. And I think as long as the funding is there to support these efforts, I think you'll see restoration that is not only able to mitigate some of these climate change effects that we're being told about, but actually improve the health of the river to a level that fish can begin to thrive again and actually maybe even withstand some of these future droughts that we're looking at.
Well, the Owyhee Dam is a gravity arch dam. It has over 500,000 yards of concrete. It stores 1,120,000 acre feet of water. Services three different organizations, the Old Owyhee Ditch Improvement District, South Border Control, and the Owyhee Irrigation District. It services a total of 125,000 acres. And normally, with normal conditions, it would supply 2 years' water supply. In 2012 was really the beginning of a great concern. Our snowpack season was short, our runoff was greatly reduced. However, we had carried over reservoir storage from the previous year, so we drafted heavily upon that. Then 2013, again, a very reduced snowpack year. Again, we drew heavily upon our reservoir storage that we had carried over. And then the beginning of 14, the growers really received a reduced allotment to their farm operations, and again in 15. And never in the project history have we had three consecutive reduced allotment years to the growers where they got only a third of their water compared to their full amount. And that's really been difficult for them.
The way I've adapted to the short water this year is to not plant some crops. I left some ground idle, about half of my sugar beet crop and probably about 2/3 of my bean crop I did not plant because of lack of water. And that way I'd have enough water to finish out the crops that I did plant.
As we sit here on July 14th looking at this cornfield, there's a couple things that really jump out at me. And first of all is the old adage of knee-high by the 4th of July, being on your way to a successful corn crop, has really gone by the wayside. And part of that is because of the varieties and the work that's been done to really push corn farther. And whether it's a matter of a little bit of frost tolerance or just the general hybrid performance of this corn, when you stand here, this is obviously far taller than knee-high on the 4th of July. You look at this corn that's in full tassel here in mid-July, the ears are in silk and are probably within a month of being physiologically ready to be harvested. It really is a huge factor in having success on a year where we don't have a full season of water.
This year really demonstrated the importance of water conservation and restoration projects around the state, and communities have been undertaking them for a number of years, not just because of drought, but they really paid dividends this year.
So we're standing here at a system that was recently installed by the Vale, Oregon Irrigation District that has really enabled the district to do a much more efficient job of delivering water. The one thing that really makes this new system advantageous to both the district and the producers are the rotary screens that have been installed in front. And the rotary screens do a fantastic job of removing debris and making sure that the water that flows into the lines remains clean. Another neat aspect of this particular design is that it has solar panels running the screen, so they did not have to bring electricity to this site to install this screening system. They're able to make it all self-contained right here. From here, it stretches out into a series of buried pipe, and it goes throughout, and it covers the same amount of area that the open ditch did before, but the difference is it delivers pressurized water as it is gravity fed down through the buried lines to the farmer's field. So traditionally, an open ditch would have had the disadvantages of water loss of an open ditch. It increased weed habitat, management issues with debris blowing into the ditch, and when a grower wanted to pressurize that water, he had to do that electronically. He had to put in a pump, a diesel pump, electric pump. He had to pressurize that water himself. Now with the buried line, they deliver pressurized water to the grower. So he has pressurized water from the moment he opens up the valve. And that has provided a huge set of advantages. We don't have the water loss, we don't have the weed pressure, and we're saving energy on the other end, not having to pressurize the water.
The changes the irrigation district has made is certainly operational changes. The system was not built to run on small amounts of water. Through conservation measures such as buried pipelines, gravity systems, we've been able to conserve water, and what little bit of water that we do have, we've been able to stretch that much farther than we would have been. With today's technology and the ability for automated sites to sit there and make water adjustments on an automatic level, where before they were manual, somebody personally had to be there, make that change on that gate or that diversion. And now that is programmed so that it provides water to the grower on a more efficient manner and more constant, which at the end of the year means that with that conserved effort and it's not lost, that we probably get 2 to 3 weeks longer irrigation season because of those efficiencies.
You know, one of the questions that we really do discuss from a point of industry and extension and growers is, where are we going, and are we taking enough steps to really prepare for a future that may not have a dependable storage water supply like our systems have been built on? And while I personally feel like we've come a long ways, I think it's easy to recognize the work that we still have to do in this valley as far as preparing for the potential for having a reduced surface water storage supply on a more consistent basis.